I heard the doorbell ring and reached for the bowl of candy on the side table. Opening the door, I found a small boy dressed in a bedsheet. His eye holes were cut out in the big, unmatched way that often precedes a homemade costume, and the edges of his glasses poked out through the holes at the edges. He held a pillowcase out to me and shook it. I chuckled a little and looked down at the small ghost that stood begging on my front porch. "Oh my, what a scary ghost! Did you come to haunt my house?" The ghost stood silently until a large, obliging woman standing on the steps behind him prompted, "What do we say, Derek?" Then he remembered. "Twick a tweet!" he yelled. I laughed and threw some candy into his pillowcase. He laughed at it and turned to leave as his mother beamed at me. "Thanks so much. You're a dear." I waved a hand at her. "A couple of bucks a week to make a kid happy is nothing. Same time tomorrow?" She laughed, like clockwork, rain or shine, and then sneezed hugely and shook her head. "Getting sick?" I asked. But she waved it off and said it was just allergies or something. They made their way to the next house on their daily route, and I closed the door behind them. Derek has been coming to my house every day at 5 p.m. for the last 2 years. All the neighbors keep a little candy for him, because they know it means a lot to him. Everyone in the neighborhood knows Derek. You can see him out riding his tricycle under his mother's watchful eye, or running to meet his father in the yard so he can wrap him in a big bear hug. The neighbors ask him to help out with their yard work, and just thank him when he refuses the money and hops off towards home. We've all been there for his family on the bad days too, when he has his tantrums or his breakdowns, but Derek's good days have certainly outweighed the bad ones. Derek has autism spectrum disorder, one of the more severe types, his mother says, and if a little trick-or-treating helps him through his day, most of us are happy to help. I went about my normal evening routine, dinner, laundry, tidying up, dishes. As I was washing up, though, I couldn't help smiling as I saw Derek walking back to his house with his mother, a half-full pillowcase swinging from his fist. It was hard to see his expression under the ghost costume, but I was sure that he was smiling and chatting animatedly to his mother. She rested a hand on the back of his head and nodded, laughing as they walked back to the house. She sneezed again as I watched them, and I almost sympathetically sneezed myself. Another sneeze followed it in close proximity, and I shook my head and hoped I wasn't getting sick too. The next day, however, found me sick as a dog. It was raining, the sky a black mass of dark purple clouds, and I woke up with a racking headache and a head full of mucus. Must have been a summer cold, I thought, but as the day went on, I wondered if it wasn't the flu or something. I had soup for lunch, along with some NyQuil, and some over-the-counter cold medication. As I popped down on the couch with a bowl of soup and a cup of tea, I tried to nurse myself back to health with a dose of TV and rest. Rain was coming down in sheets outside, and I let the pounding on the windows soothe me to sleep as the TV droned and the NyQuil did its work. I woke up with a start, though, when someone knocked on my door. The lights were off, and I thought it couldn't be much past mid-afternoon. It was very dark in the house, though. The person knocked again, but my legs wobbled like an old man's when I tried to get up. I sat right back down and looked over at the clock groggily. My goodness, it was already 5:01, and I realized that it must be Derek for his daily visit. His mother must be crazy to take him out in this weather. As he kept knocking, I finally called from the couch, "I'm not feeling well today, buddy. Let me take a rain check till tomorrow, okay?" The knocking paused, and I heard him say, "Twick or tweet!" from the front porch. It was definitely him, but my head was too spinny. I couldn't even get off the couch. I tried to appease him a few more times, even tried to get up again to no avail, but finally, I just laid back and ignored him. He didn't seem to stop, and after nearly 10 minutes of knocking, I just ran out of patience. I was considering trying to get off the couch again when he finally stopped. I heard his footsteps slowly walking down the stairs and started to get up again, wanting to stop him before he got hurt. I dozed back off again, though. The next thing I knew, the clock read 4 a.m. The rain had stopped. I wobbled up and managed to make it to the bathroom before I could piss my pants. I staggered to the kitchen to take some medicine and have a drink of water before collapsing onto the couch. I fell into a muddled sort of half-sleep after that. I was thinking about a weird dream I just had, but before I could think too much about it, I fell asleep again, and I didn't wake up until the blaring of my alarm clock upstairs forced me to wake up. I had to wobble to my bedroom and turn it off, and the act drained me enough to keep me in bed for the rest of the morning. I took it easy that day, called out from work again, and watched TV in my bedroom.
As 5 o'clock crept closer and closer, I started to feel like my old self again, and figured I'd make it up to poor Derek after leaving him hanging yesterday. I got up, put on some fresh pajamas, and made sure there was still candy in the bowl before Derek got there.
I even uncovered some full-size candy bars I'd been saving, and put them on top of the bowl just for him. I turned on the TV downstairs to wait, and as 5 o'clock came, I figured I'd hear his knock any minute. As 5 o'clock turned into 5:30 though, I started to get a little worried. I went to the door and looked up and down the block, but there was no sign of Derek or his mother. Their car was gone too, and wondered if maybe they'd went somewhere. I hoped Derek was okay. Maybe he'd gotten sick after running around in the rain yesterday. I gave it minimal thought as I went back inside to start my afternoon routine. I told myself as I prepared dinner, maybe they just went on a trip or something. I had barely started preparing the chicken when I heard a knock at the door. That made me feel a little better. Maybe Derek was just running a little late today. As I walked to the door, I saw the top of a sheeted head and grabbed the bowl of candy with a little chuckle. I just said how glad I was to see him and started to apologize for yesterday when I saw that the front porch was empty. I looked around the porch, seeing if maybe he'd hidden behind a chair or something. But when I saw that no one was there, I went back inside. I shook my head. Maybe I'd been hearing things. But no sooner had I gotten back to work when I heard a knock at the door again. Twick or tweet, I heard him trumpet from the door, and I walked back to get the candy with a big grin on my face. You got me. I wasn't expecting you to. No one was there. I looked around the porch, along the front, down the road, both ways, but Derek was nowhere to be found. I might have suspected any other kid was playing a joke on me, but jokes weren't Derek's thing. He had cried last year at the 4th of July block party when I pretended to get his nose. Only a big hug and half a dozen apologies, plus the return of his nose, had made it all better. I still had a very thorough look around the porch before I went back inside and started dinner again. The next time I heard the knock was at 6 o'clock. Again, the porch was empty. By 7 o'clock, I was starting to get annoyed. I reminded myself that if it was Derek, he didn't know any better. I needed to be patient with him. I was more curious as to why his mother was letting him do this. Was she mad that I hadn't answered the door yesterday? By 7:30, I had received 5 knocks, and still no one on my porch. I left the candy bowl on the doormat, figuring it was probably what they wanted anyway, and went back in to eat my dinner. My dinner sat uneaten by 8 o'clock, because I'd made 5 trips to the front door to see who was knocking. As the sun started to set, and the knocks continued, I felt a chill run up my spine despite the July heat. What I had thought was a prank was beginning to scare me. I'd never believed in the supernatural, but this was starting to rattle me. As 8 o'clock crept towards 9, the knocks came every 10 minutes, then every 5 minutes, then every minute. I turned up the TV and tried to ignore it, but it was impossible. The cries of "Twick or tweet" still came ever so often, but at this point, I was sure it was kids making fun of Derek. Kids can be cruel after all, but I had nearly had enough of this little joke. By 9:30, someone was slamming their fist on my door hard enough to rattle it in its frame. I took up the fire poker and stalked across the door in an angry clatter of bare feet. I was done with this, and if I needed to threaten some kids to make it stop, then so be it. I threw the door open, lifting the poker to strike, but there were no laughing teenagers or snot-nosed brats to be found. Just a boy in a bedsheet with a pillowcase. The front porch light cast a shadow across the porch, and the sight of him there at night gave me a shiver. His sheet was dirty, mud cresting around the bottom and splattering the lower parts. The left eye of his glasses was broken in a spiderweb of cracks. His pillowcase seemed to be leaking water as he stood there, and his silence was almost as unsettling as his appearance. Gone was the fastidiously clean boy in the ghost costume that I'd become accustomed to. Something about this ghost boy was more than a little unsettling. Little late for trick-or-treat, wouldn't you say, Casper? Derek didn't say anything. You haven't been the one knocking on my door all afternoon, have you?
Still, Derek didn't say anything.
Does your mother know you're out this late? She'd probably be a little worried if she... Why didn't you open the door yesterday?
For a moment, I was taken aback. Derek rarely spoke, rarely said more than 4 words at a time, often not even in an order that you can understand. But here he had delivered a whole sentence just for me. His voice, normally high and childish, with a little bit of a stutter, was harsh and croaking as it came from within his stained ghost costume. He sounded like a river toad more than a little boy. I took a step back as I tried to find my voice.
What? Why didn't you open the door yesterday? I was alone in the wain, and you ignored me. Why didn't you open the door yesterday? Why didn't you open the door yesterday? Why didn't you open the door yesterday?
His croak became a scream, and I slipped on the runner rug as I tried to backpedal into the house. My tailbone came into sudden contact with the hardwood floor, and as I looked back, I could see the ghost boy slowly making his way towards me.
Twick or tweet, give me something good to eat. If you don't, I don't care. I will drag you down somewhere. The little boy ghost chanted.
I hurried back on the runner rug, bringing my foot up and out as I pushed the door closed in one swift motion. As it slammed shut, I heard the same run of a cat scream as Derek slammed into the door, sing-songing his terrible melody and punctuating the end of each verse with a loud, hoarse scream. I stumbled to the phone and called the police. I explained to the operator what was going on and even let her hear the background noise. She told me to calm down and that she would send a patrol car around momentarily. I thanked her as I cradled the phone in my lap, and she promised to stay on the line until the police arrived. I just huddled in the living room as the slamming and screaming continued at the front door, and time seemed to stretch on endlessly. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes went by, and still the pounding and wailing came from the front door. The lights inside began to flicker and pulse as the monstrous voice rose to a crescendo. Without warning, the bulb above my head popped, and shattered glass fell all over me. I pulled my knees to my chest, put my face against my knees, and sobbed uncontrollably as the racket went on and on around me. Then, as suddenly as it had started, it stopped. The silence was deafening around me. When I lifted my head from my knees, I expected to see him inches from me. He wasn't, though, and as I looked around, I laughed a little as I realized I didn't know what to do now. I'd been tormented by some Twilight Zone kid whom I had inadvertently snubbed the day before, and now it was over. The whole situation was just ridiculous. Then, someone knocked on the door. I looked at the door, over the back of the couch, and felt a spasm of terror rush through me. The person at the door knocked again, and it wasn't the usual pounding rush I'd become accustomed to. As I got up and walked towards the door, I could imagine my trepidation was the same as Poe's character in The Raven. The knocking, knocking, knocking at my chamber door came a third time, and when someone spoke from the other side, I jumped backwards.
Hello? This is the police. We're responding to a call about a prowler.
I relaxed a little then and opened the door to reveal a male police officer standing where my ghostly knocker had stood a moment before.
Thank God you're here.
The knocking has been going on all day. Someone has been knocking on my door since 5 o'clock this afternoon, and it's become progressively more violent. It only just stopped as you pulled up, so I guess you must have spooked them off the porch. Or you must have seen them, right? I swept my eyes across the porch as I stammered this to him, figuring any minute I would see the little boy ghost. The officer fixed me with a questionable look.
Sorry, I didn't see anyone when I pulled up. Did you say this has been going on all day?
He asked, taking a notepad from his pocket.
Since 5 o'clock. Are you sure you didn't see anyone? The knocking stopped literally minutes ago. The person knocking would have been here when you pulled up.
Nope, didn't see anybody. You don't want to have any idea who might be behind this, do ya? Neighborhood kids or something?
Well, I don't know why I would be out this late, but when I opened the door to chase them off, I could have sworn that Derek Hughes from next door was here. He seemed really upset, and he was wearing his ghost costume.
Ghost costume?
The officer seemed surprised, and when I explained it to him, his face became angry. No, it couldn't have been him, he said, putting away the pad and turning to go.
Wait, it had to be him. He was in a ghost costume. He wears it every day. He's worn it for the last 2 years.
The voice underneath was... it was identical to his.
Couldn't have been, the cop said, pulling away again. I was here yesterday when his mother called. He was killed yesterday as he tried to cross the street.
My blood ran cold.
What? No, he was here. I saw him. I helped the paramedics load him into the ambulance myself, sir. His sheet was covered in blood and his mother was crying so hard, I thought we'd have to load her in next. I don't know what you're playing at, but it isn't funny.
He turned to go when the little boy ghost stepped out of the shadows between the banisters and started singing again.
Twick or tweet, give me something good to eat. If you don't, I don't care. I will drag you down somewhere.
The cops came back in a hurry when I started screaming. He couldn't see the boy, his bloody sheet clinging to his broken form and his high-pitched voice undulating like a strangled animal. He helped the paramedics load me into the ambulance, too, when I wouldn't stop screaming. I can still see him now, actually. He's hunched in the corner of my room, humming his little song. I don't dare sleep while he's here. If I close my eyes, he'll make good on his threats and drag me away to something worse than this. I can feel my eyelids getting heavy. I won't be able to hold out much longer, even after 7 sleepless days. I know the end will be soon. He stopped humming. His lenses are boring into me. I know it's almost time.
Good evening, my little creeperonies. It's me, Dr. Plague. Thank you so much for joining me this evening. You know, this story particularly hits a little close to home for me. My youngest son was actually diagnosed with autism. Though I dare say he's not quite as spooky as Derek is. Still, it always gives me a special little thrill to read this story for people. So, I hope you enjoyed it. Uh-oh, looks like it's time again to thank our Patreons. Our patron, Leslie Lou Riddle, at our $5 tier, is still my one and only patron, so thank you, Leslie. Your support means so much to me. If you too would like to become a $5 patron, you can always come by my Patreon. That's the Spooky Skeleton tier, if you were curious. If you'd also like to support the channel in some other way, you can always go to Amazon and buy a book. I suggest Stragview Stories, as I've got a soft spot for prison tales. You can find links to both in my comments section. Or you can always just come back and watch next week's video. I appreciate you guys' support any way I can get it. And as always, have a lovely evening.